Yeah, it seems like we are at war. It seems like it's the world against an invisible force of a virus that none of us can see.
Sure.
And I think it's a beautiful metaphor from my perspective. I want to just take you back because I think there's been a lot to be said about leadership and leadership, whether at the organizational level or the country level. And I think personal leadership as well. But I want to get your sense of the timing of President Cyril Ramaphosa's, what I'm calling, pulling the plug on this lockdown or shutdown as it is. What are your thoughts around the timing? Because timing matters, right? You and I have had many discussions around many great innovations that would not have seen the light of day and been as successful as they are had they not had the ideal sort of environment and the timing to be out there, right? So what's your sense of the timing that was used?
I think we've seen, you know, since the presidency of President Ramaphosa, first the initial presidency before the actual national election, and then the last, 13, 14 months, some criticism leveled against the president and the broader cabinet in terms of their ability to decisively deal with some of the social challenges that we face, the ability to decisively deal with some of the economic challenges. And on Friday night, we'll get an announcement by Moody's, which I'm going to argue is very much likely going to be a downgrade. The fact that, we have triple challenges that are often spoken about. And there's often been criticism leveled against the president that says, what has he done in terms of steady, bold, decisive leadership that takes the country in a certain direction? I think that brings us to this question around timing. I think often, certain leaders need some types of environments like the one we have now that gives him the ability to be able to use a lot of the type of leadership capabilities and strengths that he has had that perhaps haven't been able to be fully leveraged. And let's maybe talk about five of those. About a month ago, the president met with journalists in the country, and he argued or he raised with them the fact that he's not the president who's going to walk into a room and dictate the choices that we take. He's got a very collaborative, very engaging type of style of leadership. And he's articulated that. One, he's demonstrated that historically, from the 80s when he was in the trade union movement to the 90s in the negotiation of the constitution, to even the way he won the election, perhaps of the ANC, that we've seen in Nasrec. It was very much around engagement and collaboration. And I think what you've seen in the last 2 days, much to the ire in terms of some of the desperation of citizens saying, please come and speak to us, was the importance of being able to engage with a wide variety of stakeholders. And so the president has engaged with religious stakeholders, with business leaders, with parts of civil society, with, I think, labor significantly. And that collaboration, I think, was articulated in his view. So one, this ability, in your view around timing, is critical given the type of personality he has. I think the second is that collaborative type of leadership has now resulted in a view taken by the president, and very specific actions in terms of how that view is going to be implemented. Because often we think about this concept of leadership and strategy in terms of idea generation or putting together some choices, but how do we actually implement that? And I'm very heartened by what has happened today. I think so that's the second. I think the third is, back to your point, is the reality is that South Africa doesn't have the fiscal measures, the type of policy enablers that other countries perhaps could have, because we already had a very fragile economy and we've got anemic economic growth that will become even less so over the next couple of years, and so at least for the next couple of months. So I think the second part of this is that with all of the limitations that he had, he has still been able to put some measures in place in terms of support for low-income earners, in terms of tax benefits. He's still been able to put some measures in place in terms of support for small and medium enterprises with turnover in under 50 million rand. He's still been able to create a solidarity fund that I think all of us as South Africans, if we have the means, should contribute to. He's been able to galvanize support 100%. From big business leaders, including the Rupert and Oppenheimer family, that I hope will result in many other wealthier families contributing towards that solidarity fund to assist small and medium enterprises. And then very importantly, I think he's energized the nation to be able to say that in a very difficult crisis, let's come together, let's adhere to what's going to happen over the next 21 days. So that's the green shoots. That's the silver lining. Let me be play devil's advocate and really speak to some of my very real concerns and some of the anxieties that I have. I think one, We have a very challenging healthcare environment. And that challenging healthcare environment is compounded by the fact that we've got difficulties in terms of a public healthcare system that's already overburdened and overstretched. 83% of South Africans are dependent on the public healthcare environment. Number two, we've got a very limited fiscus, as we've seen by the Minister of Finance, Tito Mboweni, in terms of the allocation of budget. And so we don't have extra money. We're going to have to reallocate portions of the budget and allocate it towards some of the immediate term needs here, which means there are going to be some trade-offs. And I worry about those trade-offs. Number three, the fact that you've got a country that is starving and desperate for the oxygen of economic growth for the next 21 days. And it's the right move. It's a necessary move. It's a move that we've got to take. Is that over the next 21 days, how do we create the environment that we have some of that oxygen elements that come together?
So I think, Abdullah, I think you're giving us a nice balanced view. One that is steeped in optimism and one that's also dealing with the reality. If I take you back to your earlier point of Moody's possibly going to downgrade us, I think the globe being in such a flux at the moment, I think this is not a uniquely South African problem. It's a global problem, right? What does that mean for us from a macroeconomic perspective if Moody's downgrades us at this point? I mean, you know, the analogy that I'm using is we were a dog that was lying down already. It would be another kick. But is this the time for South Africans to really pull together and say, this is our future, that we can start to take that Moody's may hold off on a decision or keep us where we are? Okay, so I'm arguing that, you know, earlier you made the point just that Moody's may downgrade us. I'm arguing that, listen, they may just keep us up simply because, you know, the world is in a state of flux. Worst case scenario is that they do downgrade us on Friday. With a lying dog as ease, and this virus is essentially helping with just being kicked, unfortunately. And I apologize for the analogy that I'm using, but I mean it's the reality of what we face. But is this the time for South Africans, you know, the Solidarity Fund possibly being the seed of this thing, to say, South Africa, we're all in this together, we are rock bottom. How do we start growing this economy again? How do we bring the social, the political, the economic, and all of these different factors all together in a world that for me is almost saying, is this a reset button for us? Is this what we needed? If there's one thing we know, and it's true of all South Africans, you know, I always argue that we have our Twitter group, we have our social media groupings. But when stuff hits the fan, South Africans will band together. And that's something that we've got to now truly get going. But so just to that point, Abdullah, I think, what is the impact of this thing on the broader South African society? You've touched on it, but I really wanted to talk from a social perspective now and let go of the economic side. Because I think the economics are telling us what the economics are. We can see the rand-dollar exchange. We can see the markets are depressed. But I really want to understand, what does this mean for society in South Africa?
So I think one of the things that we often have to think about and really grapple with is, and if you think back to your own personal life, think back about some of the companies you've engaged with, think about some of the students that we've taught in classes, some of the dominant discourse areas in November, in December, even in January, to a large extent have now been overlaid by an entirely new normal, a new normal in terms of our paradigms, an entirely new normal in terms of the way we work, the way we live, the way we relate to one another. The way in which our workplaces are set up and structured, the way in which we interact with mobile technology, albeit in terms of a changing world of work, the way we, very importantly to your question, the way we really start to bring multiple actors together in society to engage on some of the critical issues. And so I think what is really important, and if we're able to very importantly over the next 21 days and perhaps over the next 2-3 months globally, yes, in reality, flatten the curve. If we can start looking at some of the behavioral shifts and changes that are necessary for us to do that, and we're able to perhaps then, over the next 12 months, find the right type of healthcare context to be able to address COVID-19, I think the question is, what are some of the learnings? I think the first learning is that what COVID-19 has taught us is that we have to have a much deeper sense of empathy, in that we have to move from a context of individualism to more collectivism. And I think we've realized this, that no matter your financial position, no matter your status, no matter your business card, no matter your title, we all are vulnerable And COVID-19 has given us a very clear awakening to that, right? And I think it's really opened up this ability to amplify that context of empathy. I think the second one is that it's opened up the valves of communication between actors who otherwise would not really want to connect and talk to each other. So think about the fact that political parties a few days ago came together in a room and engaged quite meaningfully in the best interests of the country. Think about the fact that there has been a number of trade-offs behind the scenes over the last 48 hours to be able to affect this lockdown. And if we can translate some of those learnings in terms of empathy, in terms of trade-offs, in terms of understanding the context of each other, and then in terms of having very hard conversations, because these aren't rosy conversations that are taking place in our capital city. They're hard but necessary conversations. I think we must have the same level of conversations, ideally when we're able to get past the effects of COVID-19 and take those conversations in terms of the real pressing issues on some of the socio-economic challenges. So I'm heartened by the fact that business has come to the party. I really think that if we can get business and some of the other actors like labor, civil society, academia to the party to have the same type of urgent conversations on the economy, on the political environment, and most importantly, on the socioeconomic dynamics, wow, won't we have a very different type of environment? And coming to your analogy, right, we're hitting the reset button. I think this is a fantastic reset button in terms of a new trajectory that South Africa can find itself in. And so I think the reality of the downgrade is that it's, I think it's priced in. I think we've seen those movements over the last 6 months accelerated because of some of the implications in the last 2 to 3 weeks. I think the market has shifted in terms of the dynamics of where there are potential investment propositions for countries. And so I think that will change. I think there will be a hit, unfortunately, if the downgrade does happen. But I think we've got bigger challenges in a global economy at the moment. And I think to a large extent, President Ramaphosa has the ability to be able to use some of the challenges of COVID to maybe perhaps galvanize some of the key actors in society.
So Abdullah, I think we've been talking a lot at the sort of the macroeconomic level. We've touched on the timing. We've touched now on sort of the downgrade. Let me ask you a very practical question now, which I think is critical to one of the many stakeholders in this ecosystem that has put their hands up, and that's business. And the question I want to ask you is quite simply, how can business build a strategy to respond? And responding in what I'm going to now truly call a VUCA world, a world that none of us actually know. When was the last pandemic? And if we think back then, business was not as sophisticated as it is now, but we also didn't have all the tools, the tech, and all of that nice stuff to be able to respond. So what are the critical things? And how do businesses build a strategy that really, really, really allows them to start responding right now?
Sure. I think it's a fantastic question. On the minds of many business leaders, right, Manoj? It's a question in terms of exactly to our point that if we're in a new normal, how do we, one, sense make, to use your words, how do we sense make what's going on around us? How do we sense make it at a macro level, at an economic level, at a sector level, at our company level, in terms of our employees, in terms of our clients, in terms of our route to market, in terms of our channels, in terms of our brand, in terms of the next 90 days in the business? And so that sense making is critical to be able to make the right choices. And so I think two things. In my view, concepts of agility and adaptability, I often argue, are fundamental tenets of disruption. And so, yes, my world, your world, the world of all of the institutions in the academic context, the world of banking and retail and insurance and financial services and government services, the world of civil society have all fundamentally shifted in the last 2 weeks. And so the challenge for all of us is to be able to say, if those are the fundamental tenets of disruption, how do we reposition? How do we adapt to this new normal? And the faster businesses are able to adapt, the faster they're able to adapt in terms of business models, in terms of strategic choices, and in terms of being able to navigate their people through it, the better. And so that's why it's this interplay between agility and adaptability. I think the second one is that we have to think about what the next 90 days is in terms of the business operations. And so for me, there are some important characteristics there. One, in a lockdown environment and in a depressed economic environment, we've got to really pressure test liquidity and P&L all the time and more regularly. I think that's so important in terms of businesses being able to manage, especially small and medium-sized businesses, manage some of the short-term liquidity challenges. The second one is the ability to be able to quickly adjust operations, but also human capital to this new normal. That perhaps there's a new way in which we're going to provide our goods and services to the market. And the less we provide a disruptive environment, but rather make it an adjustment in terms of the new normal, the better. The third one is aligned to that. I think we have to create and we have to accelerate psychological safety to our staff and to all of our clients. And I think we've got a responsibility as businesses to do that. The more we amplify psychological safety, the better it is in terms of people being able to adapt to some of that debt. I'll use a very personal example. Our dean at Gibbs, as you know, hosts a daily call with us every day with all staff of the institution. And I think it's really been incredible in terms of what that has meant to different people, including myself, as a measure of psychological safety, that we are coordinated at an institutional level. So that's the third. I think the fourth one is that businesses have to start thinking about, beyond the lockdown, what are they going to do to be able to pick up some of the pieces that are there? And that is very much around looking proactively, really playing an offensive game in terms of especially, you know, growing the business and the operations that are out there. And lastly, and perhaps most importantly, in terms of how businesses should navigate some of this year, is that if you take all of what I've spoken about, adaptability and agility, psychological safety, creating stability in terms of a new normal, managing profit and loss, ensuring that you're very clear about some of the liquidity and pressure testing some of that liquidity in the business, all of that has to be overlaid by this reality that we have to ask the question of ourselves as business leaders, what are the more medium-term choices that we're going to take as organizations? Because in my view, perhaps we're going to see a cycle, and are we ready? Yeah. Are we proactive and are we equipped in terms of riding the next wave of that cycle? And so I think, yes, there are parts of the business that have to be very defensive, but there are lots of parts of the business that have to say, in an upturn, how do we look at some of the opportunities that come through from a new context, arguably?
So, Abdullah, I'm going to add one point onto that. Right. Because I think we're going to have to start thinking differently. I think the way we've been thinking currently has been we've just got to start changing the manner in which we think. I think risk, the ability to make risk-based decision-making, as I call it, the ability to understand, which is famously a book by Nassim Taleb, right, on the Black Swan events.
Yeah.
It's highly improbable, but when that improbability does come along, it can wipe out an entire company, as we saw in 2008, 2009, okay. Cause a global recession economically, which had social impacts, or the highly improbable of a pandemic, which essentially brings every facet of every country down to its knees very quickly.
Yeah.
And old thinking is not going to be able to get us into the future.